May 7, 1915, the great cruise liner the Lusitania is within sight of the Scottish coast. Suddenly, a periscope breaks through the waves, and a German U-boat is about to rewrite the history books. The Lusitania was launched in 1906 as a luxury cruise liner, much like a similar ship such as the infamous Titanic. This was the age of the luxury liner, with fierce competition, especially between Britain and France, to design and launch the grandest and fastest ships in the world. Owned by Cunard Shipping Line, the Lusitania was partly funded by the British military, on the condition that if war were to break out, the mighty ship would serve as a cargo vessel. When World War I broke out in 1914, the Lusitania was not pressed into service as expected, and instead remained as a passenger liner. Instead, the ship was secretly retrofitted for potential wartime service, with expanded cargo holds and even well-camouflaged gun turrets hidden under coils of rope on the deck. This was before the British Admiralty had come to appreciate the threat posed by German U-boats. The British Navy dwarfed the German Navy, and the idea that it would be the Germans who starved Britain into submission instead of the other way around was a laughable one as the war began. However, Germany understood its tactical position far better than even the British, and knowing it could not compete with the Royal Navy on the surface, it took to new technology to subvert it from below, the infamous U-boat. Early U-boats were less true submarines and more temporarily submerged craft. Their electric batteries would allow them to cruise under the water and out of sight of surface ships, but they regularly needed to surface in order to run their diesel engines and recharge their batteries. If they wanted to move at any significant speed, they had to do so on the surface as well, where they were incredibly vulnerable to enemy fire. However, U-boats could remain submerged long enough to break the British blockade in the North Sea and move it into the Atlantic, where they could wreak havoc on British shipping. International law mandated that U-boats follow prize laws. These rules of war were aimed at limiting the devastation of war. Under these laws, U-boats must allow a merchant ship to evacuate their vessel and get to safety unless they were close to land, in which they could remain in their lifeboats. More importantly, the law stated that passenger ships may not be sunk. As the war progressed, the Germans obeyed these laws. But then the British changed the rules. An empire that depended wholly on the sea, Britain was particularly vulnerable to Germany's blistering successful U-boat campaign against it. Soon, the British began to arm merchant vessels with hidden guns. Under international law, U-boats were forced to surface and warn merchants their vessels were to be sunk, which gave British Q-ships, as they came to be called, time to unveil their hidden guns and sink the U-boat. This blatant exploitation of international law led to Germany declaring a war zone around the British Isles on February 4, 1915. This now meant that any ship entering those waters and flying the British flag was under threat of German attack. This move deeply angered neutral countries, especially the US, and in a bid to avoid any unfortunate catastrophes, the German embassy in the United States put out ads in newspapers warning that Britain had been declared a war zone and that ships sailing to England should be avoided. The declaration of a war zone around British waters was an unexpected boon to the British. For a long time, the British Admiralty, led by young Winston Churchill, had been pushing for a strategy to lure in neutral ships in the hopes that they'd be attacked by the Germans. As Churchill himself said, if a neutral ship should be attacked and end in tragedy, all the better. Arming merchant vessels wasn't the only way a desperate Britain was flouting international laws, however, as it was also using civilian ships to transfer desperately needed supplies from the US. Passenger liners were off-limits targets to German U-boats, a fact that the British took advantage of by smuggling war supplies in their holds. Germany repeatedly warned Britain and the US about this practice, but it was ignored. Germany thus had no choice, and with the declaration of a war zone around Britain, unrestricted submarine warfare would begin. Ignoring all warnings that any ship flying the British flag would be attacked, passengers boarded the Lusitania in the New York Harbor on May 1, 1915. As they boarded, several of the ship's wealthiest passengers received an emergency telegram warning them that the Lusitania was under U-boat threat. The passengers ignored this telegram, laughing it off as a joke. They'd been reassured that the Lusitania was too fast for any U-boat, and were still under the impression that even if they were attacked, the Germans would allow them to board lifeboats before sinking the ship. They couldn't have been more wrong, and the ominous telegram, whose origin remains a mystery to this day, was no joke. The British Admiralty had broken the German radio codes and been listening in on its communications with its U-boats for a while now. While U-boats were still incredibly difficult to locate, they listened as the commander of a U-boat U-20 departed his anchorage in North Germany and then communicated that he had arrived on station off the Scottish coast. The British knew that a U-boat was in Lusitania's path and were keenly aware of the 128 Americans on board the ship, yet they said nothing. in the hopes that if the Americans met with tragedy, it would spur them to join the war. 6 days after leaving New York with the coast in sight, a U-boat U-20 fired a single torpedo at the Lusitania. The explosion tore a massive hole in the side of the large ship, and she began to take on water. Moments later, a second explosion rocked the cruise liner, sealing her fate. Other ships had taken much greater damage than her and sunk in hours. Yet the Lusitania was under the waves in less than 20 minutes, dooming most of her passengers. The second explosion, long believed to be the result of secret munitions being carried in her hold, was actually due to a boiler exploding on contact with ice-cold water, adding to the damage and increasing the rate of flooding. However, what truly doomed the ship was the lack of electricity, which prevented watertight doors across compartments from being closed and sealing off the flooded sections. In short order, nearly 1,200 people were dead, including 128 Americans and over 100 children. When news of her sinking spread around the world, the British Admiralty went into a panic, trying to conceal the real circumstances behind the sinking. All evidence at the time wrongly pointed to the secondary explosion being caused by the secret munitions being set off, and the truth wouldn't be discovered until nearly 80 years later. At the time, however, the Admiralty had to suppress all evidence of the secret munitions or risk losing goodwill from the world community. They had to desperately spin the event as a bloodthirsty attack on an innocent passenger liner, especially in America, as the fate of the war depended on this one big lie. The Admiralty, however, also had to ensure that the Americans never discovered that they'd been aware of the pending attack the entire time. If Washington ever found out that the Admiralty had intercepted U-20's messages, they might not only refuse to join the war, but might even cut off all aid completely. Luckily for the British, the American public was swept up in anti-German furor over the sinking of the Lusitania, and the fact that the British had been aware of the pending attack wouldn't come to light until decades later. Americans were angry, with many clamoring for war against Germany, but President Woodrow Wilson remained reluctant to embroil the US in a European war. Then, in August, a German U-boat sunk yet another British ocean liner, the SS Arabic, which also had Americans on board. The Germans claimed the attack had been in self-defense, as the Arabic was attempting to ram them. Truthfully, British ships had been instructed to do just that if they encountered a U-boat, as their massive bulk would easily cut a U-boat in half. President Wilson warned Germany that if their investigation of the incident proved Germany was at fault, it could lead to a war. Germany conceded and announced that it would once more instruct its U-boats to warn merchant ships and get their crews to safety before sinking the ship, as the British were still actively arming their merchant ships, also against international law. This placed German U-boats at huge risk, but for the Germans it was favorable to the U.S. entering the war on the side of the British. The U.S. would remain neutral for two more years, until British intelligence intercepted a telegram from the German foreign minister to the German minister to Mexico. The telegram stated that Germany would once more resume unrestricted submarine warfare in a bid to cut off supplies to England, and that it would begin to sink any ship flying the British flag. It specifically warned that this would include even ships carrying American passengers, and attempted to draw up a contingency should the U.S. enter the war. In exchange for Mexico's aid against the U.S., the Germans would offer large amounts of financial aid and help it restore its lost territories of Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. The intercepted telegram was rushed to President Wilson, who was immediately outraged. In an unprecedented move, the president authorized for the telegram to be published in its entirety in American newspapers, stoking anti-German sentiment to a fever pitch. Just days later, the American Congress approved the U.S.'s entry into the war on the side of the Allies, just as Britain had always wanted and been willing to trade innocent American lives for. Now, go watch How Did World War I Start? Or click this other video instead.